The following is a class on the Bhagavad Gita as it is, second chapter, text number 48, given by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, recorded in the summer of 1966 in New York.
Now, spiritual consciousness and to continue it. Simple theoretical knowledge that I am consciousness, I am not this body, anything, simple theoretical knowledge cannot help us. We can put on this light. Unless just like a person, he studied medical science or law, anything, any technical science, he gets all theoretical knowledge. But if he does not practice, then that knowledge will gradually subside. Similarly, that I am not this body, but I am the pure consciousness that is already analyzed in various ways. Now, we are in practical life. Now, if we say that I am not this body, so what is the use of working for this body? The whole world is moving under the bodily conception of life. Because I am born in this land, my body is born out of this land, American land. Therefore, I am thinking American. Because I am born in India, therefore I am thinking Indian. Because I am born of a certain family, therefore I am identifying myself with that family. Because my father has given me some name, so I am identifying with that name. So, my position is that I am all around surrounded by this bodily conception of life. Now, from studying Bhagavad Gita or deeply thinking over the matter, I come to understand that I am not this body. That is settled. That's all. But actually, I am working on bodily plane. This adjustment is required. Yes, you, for the present moment, because you are entangled or enwrapped within this, encased within this body, so you cannot say that I will work without this body. But you can work in such a way that even without this body, even with this body, you can work in your spiritual platform. Although I am in this bodily conception of life, still I can work from the spiritual platform. That technical knowledge is instructed by Lord Krishna to Arjuna, that you are not this body, but you have to work at the same time. Then how? Now here is the formula. Yogastha kuru karmani. Yogastha. Yogastha means that you remain in spiritual consciousness, but at the same time you go on with your usual work. You remain in spiritual consciousness and go on with your work. So this is very difficult. I am working with bodily conception of life. How I can be situated in spiritual conception of life? So, this technique is Sangam Tatya Dhananjaya. Sangam Tatya Dhananjaya. Without being touched with bodily conception. And how it can be done? Na siddhya siddho samanga bhutva samattam yoga uchat. That neutrality will be that in the former verse it has been already explained that you have right to work but not for the result. Don't be cause of the effect of your result. Then you will be bound up. You are being bound up by reaction of every work. It is just like this world is so situated that you know that a sound vibration practically nowadays everyone knows it, that any sound vibrated, it, you know, within a second it takes round all over the world 7 times. It is so, the arrangement is so. Just like in a pond, if you drop a stone, the circle begins to enlarge. And so, similarly, we catch the radio vibration. You know, there is numbers and a certain vibration, you can catch the sound. So, the whole arrangement is like that. Now, if we work even in that arrangement, yogastha, being situated in my spiritual plane, then that will reach to the spiritual sky by enlargement of the circle. Enlargement of the circle. I can do work. Here, you'll find in the Bhagavad Gita that the Lord says that patram pusvam phalam toyam yome bhakta prajacchati. Anyone who offers in devotion patram pusvam, a little flower, a small leaf, a little water, I accept them because it is offered to me in devotion, therefore I accept them. I take them in my hand. But people may ask questions, say, where is the hand? Where is the hand of God? He says that I take. I take means I take it in my hand. Without hand there is no question of taking. Therefore, Vedic hymn says, the apadapani javanagrahita. The Lord has no legs, no hands, but still he can work more than the speed of the air, more than the speed of the mind, and he can accept whatever we offer. But he has no hand, he has no leg. So this means that he has no hand, he has no leg, like our limited measured hand or leg. He can stretch his hand anywhere. And similarly, he can stretch, he can hear from anywhere. That is the prerogative of the Supreme Lord. I have given you several times the example that the sun is far, far away from us. Still, he can distribute his heat and light to us. So, if we work with God consciousness, although we are here in this platform, material platform, that work is admitted by the Supreme Lord. That is called yogas. Yoga means keeping touch with the Supreme. That is called yoga. There are different kinds of yoga mentioned in the Bhagavad Gita, especially Jnana Yoga, Karma Yoga, and Bhakti Yoga. And within Jnana Yoga, there are many other yogas, Dhyana Yoga, Hatha Yoga, so many things. Now, here it is said that yogasya kuru karmani. You be situated in your yoga or a meditation. Generally, yoga is understood as meditation. But yoga, real meaning of yoga, to keep in touch with the Supreme, that is called yoga. To keep in touch. So you have to work from the platform of spiritual consciousness. At the same time, you have to work. The Lord never says that you stop work. Never says. Arjuna's friend was Lord Krishna. But Krishna never said he is God himself. He is the Supreme Personality of God himself. He never said Arjuna that I am your friend. I shall supply all your necessities. You don't require to work. You stop. No, he never said. Rather, Arjuna was declining to fight, but Krishna is inducing him to fight. So, in spiritual platform, there is no question of stopping work. No question of stopping work. But work for the Supreme. That's Ishavasamidam Sadhana, with God consciousness. Now, there are three processes of yoga. Jnana Yoga, and Karma Yoga, and Bhakti Yoga. Now, Jnana Yoga, take for example Jnana Yoga. Jnana Yoga means to keep in touch with the Supreme by a speculation of higher knowledge. That discriminating what is spirit and what is matter. So there are philosophers, they are discriminating that this is matter, neti neti, this is matter and this is spirit. Now that requires study and that requires knowledge also. Now suppose a man is neither educated, neither he has got sufficient knowledge, philosophical knowledge, then what happens to him? He will not be able to perform yoga sakuru karmani? No. He is also a bona fide person. He can also perform the work. Because he has no knowledge and because he is uneducated, that doesn't mean that he cannot do he cannot work from the spiritual platform. He can also do. That how he can do, that is the technique. This technique is explained here with the Siddha-Siddho-Samobhutva. That you do not be anxious for the success and failure of the attempt you are making. Success and failure. A common example can be cited in this connection. Suppose you are working for your master. You are working in a farm for selling something. The master says that you go and find out some customers for this particular thing. You go out. You go out. Now, you sincerely work for it. Suppose you get business worth $100,000 or something like that. And suppose one day you don't get any business. Now, the day in which you got some business and the day in which you did not get any business, it doesn't matter. Your connection with the master is there, so you get your salary. When the profit is $100,000, you don't expect any profit out of it. And when there is no business, so there is no loss on your part. Siddhyasiddhi. Similarly, if you act on behalf of the Supreme Lord, you can do any work you are situated, that doesn't matter. But if you act on behalf of the Supreme Lord, just like Arjuna is being requested indirectly, that Lord Sri Krishna says that this fighting is my plan. So if you work for it, so you have nothing to enjoy or suffer out of the reaction, because you shall work under my instructions. That is the, if we work on behalf of the Supreme Lord, then that is called yogastha. So our work is also not stopped, and at the same time I am situated in the spiritual platform. That technique is taught by Lord Krishna. Yogastha kuru karmani taktya sangam dhananjaya. You do not be attached with the profit and loss of anything, but you simply do your duty. You don't care for the success or failure, and if you are, steady, either in success or failure, so that is called yoga. That is called yoga. Don't mind for the success or failure. Do act on behalf of the Supreme Lord. And if you are steady in that position, then your working in a spiritual platform is successful. The sangam takta means don't be associated with the result of the work. Let the result come, whatever it may. But you have to do your duty nicely and for the sake of God. Sangam takta kattitta abhinivesanta takta yugasthal sang karmani kuru yuddhari. Kattitta means that you are the doer, forget this. You are not the doer. You are being ordered to do it. Just like there is an example that you take a rod and kill a snake. Now the rod is practically killing the snake, but actually the rod is not responsible. Because the man who has taken the rod, who is killing the snake, he is responsible for killing the snake, not the rod. So we have to become the rod in the hand of the Supreme. Then all the reaction of our work will be, I will not be responsible for the reaction. The Lord will be responsible for that. That is the system. Yogastha kuru karmani sangam takta dhananjaya. Now, for a householder, according to our Vedic system, I have already described to you the four divisions of social system and four divisions of spiritual orders. Now all these social system and orders, they are so designed that everyone is working for the satisfaction of the Supreme Lord. In a higher section of the social order, just like the Brahmins and the Kshatriyas and the Vaishyas, the system is that in every household they establish the deity and the form of the Supreme Lord. Either in picture or in idol, they establish that. Now, what is the function in your household affairs? You have got wife, you have got children, and you require some money, and the activities in household affairs is that you have to get some store from the market, and they are brought in your house, and they are stocked, and in due time they are cooked, and you take your food stuff and then go to your work. This is generally the whole system of household work. Now, here, the Yogas Thakur Karmani, in India, there are many families still, at least in my family, when I was family man, I was also doing this, that the deity, Lord Krishna, the murti, murti means deity, the idol of Radha Krishna, established in a room. That is called the God's room. The God's room. So our duty is to rise early in the morning and open the door of the God's room, offering some prayers and some kirtan, and then clean the room, and then begin our daily duty, take our breakfast. The whole idea is that the proprietor of this house, he is the Supreme Lord. And we are all workers. The whole idea is the proprietor is the Supreme Lord and we are all workers. Now, I am going to my office, to my work, to earn some money, because without money, my household affairs cannot be run. So I am thinking that this money is required, otherwise God's service will be stopped. So in earning that money in my office or in my workshop, my God consciousness is there. Therefore, even in earning, whatever may be the process, you are yoga. You are situated in yoga. Now you get your money, then you go to the market, you are thinking, oh, this is a very nice thing, or it can be offered to Lord Krishna. It can be offered to Lord Krishna, just like sometimes you bring some fruits for me, thinking out of your love, oh, Swamiji, I will take this, you like it. So the consciousness is love, out of love you think of Swamiji. Similarly, Swamiji is third because he is in relation with God. So similarly, we can think of also God. God or anything in relation with God, that is God consciousness. Just like electric charge, anything connected with the powerhouse and anything later on connected with that powerhouse link, everything is surcharged with electricity. So our life should be so formed that in our every activity there will be God consciousness. That is the technique of yoga. You haven't got to separately being seated in meditation as yoga, generally as you understand. Now how much you can devote your time to meditation? Suppose 1 hour in the morning or 1 hour in the evening, you can devote. But if you mold your life in such a way that always, 24 hours, you are in meditation, that is the platform of Yoga Sattva Karma. I am earning for the Supreme Lord. Then when I earn, I bring things for cooking. I am thinking, oh, this thing will be cooked for Lord. Now your wife cooks, and she is also very clean because it is being cooked for Lord Krishna. Now, as far as I am concerned here, I also cook myself, my food, and offer to Krishna. And therefore, I ask my friends that unless it is offered to Krishna, you please do not take it. You see. Sometimes, and I see that in your country, while cooking, they taste, but I request them that don't taste before the cooking is finished. After cooking is finished, and when it is offered to the deity, then you take as much as you like. So that means there is God consciousness. That this thing is being cooked for the Lord. The cooking will go on. If you don't think of God, you require cooking because you want to eat. The cooking is there in the program. But if you think that this cooking is done for God, then your God consciousness is there. The cooking you cannot avoid. As a householder, you have to cook for yourself, you have to cook for your children, you have to cook for somebody else or for your own self. That I am cooking, I have no here family or children, but I am cooking for myself. So cooking you cannot stop. But if you cook with the understanding that this foodstuff is being cooked for the Lord may be offered first, then you shall take. This is God. This is consciousness. But is it very difficult thing? Anyone can accept it. Anyone can do it. It is not difficult because your cooking business is not stopped. Simply the mode of thinking has to be changed. That's all. A small technique that I am earning for God, I am cooking for God, I am eating also for God. And that eating because my body is dedicated to the service of the Lord. If I don't eat sufficiently to keep my body fit, then how can I work? So your eating is also God consciousness. Your sleeping is also God consciousness. So that is the way we have to mold our life activities. Now, when I think that I have to keep this body fit for working for God, so then that is not bodily conception of life. Just like when you think that my car has to be kept very nicely so that I can take nice work for it, then you are not identified with your car. You simply want to take some service of the car. Similarly, if you think that this body is required for acting, for working on behalf of the Supreme Lord, therefore I must keep the body fit to work. So that is not your identification with the body. But if I use this body for sense gratification, and therefore I make my body stout and strong to enjoy sense enjoyment, that is the cause of my bondage. So it is a simple technique, and we have to understand it, and we have to act it on the program as they have been made by experienced devotees. Now another thing, take this see the advantage of God consciousness. Now if you have got determination that I shall not take anything which is not offered to God. Because your life is meant for God's service. You earn for God, you cook for God, you eat for God. Therefore, the whole life is like that. Now, if you are cooking for God, if you are purchasing stores for God, then you have to know what sort of things can be offered to God. Because always remember that you are going to the store not for your own purpose. You'll find in later chapters that pachante te adhang papam. The idea is that anyone who is doing everything for the sake of the Lord, he is freed from the reaction. But anyone who is doing anything on his own account, he is being entangled in that action and reaction. So that is the technique of becoming Jogastha. Jogastha Kuru Karma. And the next slok, in next slok, it is very clearly explained that Durena Jabaram Karma Buddhi Yoga Dhananjaya Buddho Saranam Anicca Kripana Phalahitavaha. Kripana Phalahitavaha. Now, here is the word Kripana is very significant. Kripana. There are two classes of men. The Kripana means miser. Kripana. Miser. And that's the opposite word of Kripana is Brahmana. I have already explained to you sometimes that Brahmana means who knows that I am not this body, I am spirit consciousness, one who knows perfectly well this understanding and the science also, that I am qualitatively one with the Supreme Lord, Aham Brahmasmi. The Vedic mantra says, Aham Brahmasmi. That means I am Brahma. I am not this matter, I am Brahma. So one who knows this science, he is called Brahman. And that doesn't matter who is he and where he is born. That doesn't matter. Simply knowing this science. Now, the opposite word is Kripana. Kripana means miser. Whom you call miser? The miser is a man who has got enough money but does not spend it. He is called miser. Miser means who has got enough assets but he does not spend. He simply sees his money and satisfied. He does not spend it, properly utilize it. That is, he is called Kripana. Is it right, the miser explanation? Of this Kripana. So Kripana, who is Kripana? And who is Brahmana? Brahmana means who has known that I am spiritual identity. I am qualitatively one with the Supreme Lord. I am the part and parcel of the Lord. This knowledge, one who has developed highly and perfectly, he is called Brahmana. And Kripana means who has not utilized this human form of body to understand that he is a spiritual identity, Brahma, but he simply knows that I am this body, and because this body is born in a certain place, so I am identified to that country or to that society or to that family. They are called Kripana. Kripana means that he has not properly utilized the developed consciousness he has got in his asset. A human being has got the developed consciousness than others, subhuman or the animal society. So he has to utilize
Just like you have got 100,000 of dollars. Now if you properly utilize, it can be increased. It can be increased to millions of dollars by your intelligence if you utilize. But if you do not utilize it, if you keep it as it is, that is also very good. But sometimes we lost the whole thing. But they are called cripples. Foolishness. So, we must utilize this human form of body properly to understand that I am not this body. I am pure consciousness. And this pure consciousness I have to practice in such a way that in next life I get my pure consciousness into pure spiritual body, not again this material body. This material body, we must always know, this is a foreign thing. We have already explained to you that this is just like dress. Dress is a foreign thing to my body. Similarly, this gross and subtle body, gross body of these material five elements, and the subtle body of mind, ego, and intelligence, they are my foreign things. So, I am now encased in foreign things. My whole life mission is to get out of these foreign things. I want to be situated in my real spiritual body. That can be done if you practice. If you practice during this life, you always be spiritually situated. Then your next life, after living even within this body, when you get clear conception that I am not this body, and you are clearly working on from the spiritual platform, as Lord Krishna prescribes here, the yoga sakuru karmani, be situated in yoga and act in your daily duties. Then, similarly, if we practice this, to work in such a way that we have to work from the spiritual platform, then in your next life will be free from this material bondage and you get your freedom life. Spiritual body means your freedom life. We do not know, we have no conception that in our spiritual body how much we can be powerful. We do not know that. There is calculation. There is calculation. Suppose God is 10% perfect. So when you get your spiritual body, you may not be as powerful as God, but almost near to God. You get 78%. You get 78% of the whole power. That is a calculation by the great sages. They have calculated that a living entity can attain to the perfection of 78%. Now, in our present material condition, we have no spiritual power at all. We are always encumbered and conditioned by material forces. You see? So, therefore, one who does not utilize this body for perfection, for liberation, he is called Kripana. Kripana. This is stated here. Kripana phalahe tava. Kripana phalahe tava. That Kripana, that means miserly person who does not utilize this human form of life for better profit, then he wants that, I have done so much, I must get the profit. I must get the what profit here? For the bodily enjoyment, for sense enjoyment, sacrifice it. Sacrifice it. You know that there is a word in yoga, sacrifice. And sacrifice means, it is a common word, that you dedicate your life for the service of the Lord. This life. You will not be sufferer. You know, what is their suffering? Now, just the prescription or the formula I just cited before you, your householder life. Now, you are doing everything. You are earning money, you are getting from the store, you are cooking, everything, nothing is stopped. Simply change your mentality that everything is being done for. It's not at all difficult. Simply, we have to adopt it. We have to adopt it. So kripana phalaita. Now, if you think that, why I am earning for my palatable dishes, why shall I offer it to God? This is, there are so many encumbrances. I'm not going to do it. Then you become kripana, miser. But if you be a Brahman, Brahman means udara, liberal. The opposite word of kripana is liberal. I offer this body for the service of the Supreme. I become so liberal. Not for my sense enjoyment. The one who engages this body for sense enjoyment, he is called kripana miser. And one who engages this body for the service of the Supreme Lord, he is called brahmana. Lord says that you don't be kripana, you don't be miser. Miser want. Now, here, suppose there are so many rich men in your country and so many foundations also. I tell you my practical experience. I wrote some letters to some good foundation that I want to start here in America an institution for God consciousness, international institution for God consciousness. You kindly help me. Now, they have flatly refused that our place is not anything for religion or God. Just see. That means, according to Bhagavad Gita, they are all misers. Although they have got very good foundation, they are making actually some charity, but then misers, they do not know where to make charity. Karmajo, it will be clearly stated by Lord in later chapter. Jat karosi, jat juhosi, jadasnasi, jadasi jat, kurus satat madarpanam. The karmajoga process is that whatever you do, whatever you take trouble for, whatever you eat, everything offered to. That is called karmajoga or jugastha. But the people have developed such a consciousness at the present moment that whenever they hear of God or whenever they hear of some religion, they at once become adverse to it. In my country also the same position. Now this book, my Srimad Bhagavatam, it is recognized by the government. The Ministry of Central Government, they have recognized this book and they are purchasing 100 copies of each part. They have recognized. But when I told that for this publication of the whole thing, I require $500,000, government can take up this work. No, our government is secular. So, I could not get any help from my government. And here also, I approached some foundation, and here's my program, that I want to start one institution for God consciousness. Please, the institution will be established in your country, your people will be benefited, I don't take any money, I don't make any profit, I want to simply give my service And I got there later, and the Rockefellers found it, and they are flatly, no, we are not going to contribute anything for religious purpose or for God's purpose. It is not possible. The people have become so averse to the sense of God. How they can be happy? At least from the Bhagavad Gita, we find it clearly. They cannot be happy. However they make progress in material advancement of science and economy and everything, oh, they cannot be happy. They cannot be happy. The whole thing is the wrong process. Here is the process recommended in the Bhagavad Gita, that yogastha kuru karmani. Yogastha kuru karmani. Unless you work, your work is, no work is condemned. Whatever you do, that doesn't matter. But if that work is done on behalf of the Supreme Lord, that makes you purified, that makes you happy. Now that science is lacking altogether all over the world. Not only here or there, the whole thing, in Russia they are preaching godless civilization, there is no God. Here also there are even some churches, I know, they are preaching the God is dead. You see, they are preaching like that. So the condition is very precarious at the present moment. We are preaching Bhagavad Gita and the formula, but the formula is practically very difficult to apply in the present circumstance. Yoga Sakurukavani. People have gone so much ahead in material material civilization means only sense gratification, that's all. It has nothing more than this. And actually we are seeing that as much as we are making economic progress, as much money we are getting, the next program is how to spend it for sense gratification. How to spend it for sense gratification. They have no other program. No other program. You see, everywhere. But here, the formula is that nothing for your sense gratification. Everything for God. The work is not condemned. Work you can do. Whatever in situation, position you are, by God's will you are put in, that doesn't matter. Your work is not bad, provided you work for the Supreme Lord. That is the fact. Durena jabaram karma. Yeah, it is emphatically emphasized. That durena jabaram karma buddhi yogat dhananjaya. By application of this God consciousness, you throw away all other work. Any work which you cannot do with God consciousness, don't do it. Now here is the injunction, Bhagavad Gita. Say anything which you cannot do with God consciousness, stop doing. But the whole world is engaged doing things in which there is no God consciousness. There is no God consciousness. But here it is enjoined that buddhau saranam mannicca kripana phalahitava. Only those who are kripana, those who are not self-realized, they are hankering after sense gratification. They want to enjoy the fruits of their labor. But you don't be, Arjuna, you don't be. If you want to be spiritually situated, if you want to work from the spiritual platform, then you don't do it. You work on the spiritual platform and don't do anything which you cannot do in God consciousness. This is clearly stated here. Now, it is of course, it depends on us whether to accept it or not accept it, because God has given us independence. You will find also in the Bhagavad Gita at the end that after the instruction is given, the Lord inquires from Arjuna that I have given you all instructions necessary. Now, whatever you like, you do. So this is the position. Hey, the Lord never interferes with the little independence that has been offered to us. We have got little independence because we are part and parcel of the Supreme Lord. So under certain percentage, we have got independence, not full independence, but under certain percentage we have got independence. And that independence we can use properly or misuse it also. When we misuse, then we become Kripana, the miser. And when we use it properly, then we become Brahmana. Durena jabaram karma buddhi yoga dhananjaya buddhau saranam anicca saranam anicca kripana apalata. Buddhi, by intelligence. By intelligence, you take shelter of the Supreme Lord. Don't be miser and be hankering after the result of your work and enjoy for yourself. Oh, sacrifice. Sacrifice means you sacrifice your energy. God is not hankering after your money or whatever you have got. He is full in himself. He is full in himself. He doesn't require. Now, in India there is a system of worshipping the Ganges water. Ganges water. Ganges water, there are five sacred rivers which the Hindus, they worship. They are Ganga, Jamuna, Kaveri, Godavari, Narmada. Just like you have got your Hudson River here, similarly, there are many rivers, and one of them, these five rivers, they are accepted as a sacred river, and people take their bath and offer their respect. Now, what is the process of respect? The process of respect is just like worshipping the Ganges water. Now, after taking your bath, you stand on the water and take little water from the river, just like this. The river is flowing. You take little water like this and chant your mantra and offer it. Now, this offering of water, where from the water is come? Oh, you are taking the water from the Ganges. You have not brought even the water from your house. You are taking the water from the Ganges and you are again and offering the same to the Ganges with some mantra. Similarly, the Ganges has got immense water. If you take one palm full of water out of it, the Ganges is not in loss. And again, if you offer a palm full of water on the Ganges does not gain anything. But utilizing the Ganges water and offering to the Ganges, you become a devotee of Ganges. Similarly, the offering to Lord, what you have got? Your body, it is also given by God. Your intelligence, it is given by God. The facility of work, it is given by God. Everything is given by God. Now what do we work? Now suppose I am writing books. Alright. In which you are writing? Then paper. Alright. Who has given you paper? Now you make philosophical study. Well, paper I purchased from the market. Market, how does it supply paper? Now it is manufacturing means. Oh, it is manufacturing means. Where they get the raw materials? Oh, from the wood. How the wood is produced? Oh, then you come to the God. You cannot produce the wood. You simply bring wood from the forest and get it to chemically purified and make a plaster and the paper is made. So no raw material you can manufacture. Raw material has to be taken from God's stock. But if the raw material is taken from God's stock, then how the paper becomes yours? This is God consciousness. This is everything we'll find. that nothing is ours. We simply, the economists also say, that we cannot manufacture anything. We can simply transform from one form to another.
That's all.
We can give on labor only. And that labor also, giving the strength. Now suppose I work with my hand. Now, I am claiming this is my hand. But if God withdraws the power of your hand, paralyzed, oh, your pride is at one time, not your hand. You see? So everything. Nothing is yours. I am also a spirit soul. I am also part and parcel of God.
And we are thinking independently that I have no connection with God.
This is a very horrible condition. The whole world is suffering because this misconception of life. Misconception of life. That he has forgotten his eternal relationship with God. So, we have to revive. We have to revive this process. The Bhagavad Gita has prescribed. Durena chavaram kanna buddhi yoga dhananjana buddhau saranam manne chak kripana palahetava. Kripana means those who are anxious for enjoying sense gratification by the fruits of their labor. They are called kripana. And those who have sacrificed the whole body, whole intelligence, sacrifice, you always remember, what we can sacrifice. Just like we take Ganges water from Ganges and offering it. So everything is obtained from God. And now if we offer the same thing to God, then we become liberated. Actually, I am not proprietor in anything. Myself is also not. I am also the part and parcel of the Supreme Lord. These are the conceptions. Without this conception, without this God conception, there is no spiritual realization and there is no happiness either personally or impersonally or socially or economically or politically. That cannot be. Of course, today there is no time. Otherwise, I would have recited. Those who have bought my books, you will see that how much profusely the earth was producing during the time of Maharaj Yudhishthira. Because the executive head of the state was a fire, so how nature was helping. Nature was helping. Now India, there is scarcity. Scarcity of foodstuff. But the same India was producing so much grain, even during British time, that many thousands and thousand tons of rice were being exported from India to other countries. That I have seen. My maternal uncle was very rich man, was simply exporting rice to the foreign countries. Spices, an old history will find that India, they had got their own ships for exporting spices to Greece and other countries of Europe. The history is there. They were supplying a Muslim clothes. Even just before the British period, Muslim period. So India's statistics was far greater than other countries. And these spices and other export attracted persons from Europe. The Vasco da Gama, the Columbus also wanted to go, but he fortunately came to America. You see, all these Europeans and the Britishers went and established their supremacy. So India was so rich. But now, how that India has become so poor? The same land is there. Why? Because they have lost that old culture, God consciousness. My calculation is this. The state, secularization, he has not. Here in America, you have got state religion. You have got state religion. But in India, there is no state religion. Every country has state religion. Even Pakistan, it has divided, it is now a part of India. But they have also their state religion. But unfortunately, India has no state religion. That means, deliberately, they are trying to disconnect with God religion. God religion. But in the same India, you just read the history at 5,000 years before, how much profusely the nature was supplied. In the morning, we are studying portion, Mr. Paul was reading that portion, how much nature was giving. So nature can give you anything. Maybe after all, it is the nature that supplies your necessities, not the industry. Industry simply transformed in a different way and a certain class make profit out of it. Industry does not mean really economic improvement. Real economic improvement means what you produce from the land. That requires God's help. Without raw materials, even your industry cannot go on. Just like I cited the example of paper. Now, paper, nowadays paper is made from wood. Now, if there is no sufficient, now you have gotten in America sufficient wood, so you can produce paper in large quantity. But suppose the woods are finished, then the industry will be finished. Anyway, no, we should always be in concept that everything that we have in our possession, even our body, even our mind, even our energy, everything, that is God-gifted. One who has got this conception of life, he is Brahman. He is the one who knows Brahman. One who does not know and simply live for sense gratification, he is called the miser. So we shall not be miser, we shall be the Brahmana.